Ireland, one of the longest struggles for independence. After centuries of domination by the British, the Irish people gain a measure of freedom. The year is 1921. After 5 years of guerrilla warfare, the IRA, the Irish Republican Army, led by Michael Collins, defeats the most powerful empire of that time. The IRA declaration addressed to all people of Ireland is directly inspired by the French and American revolutions. The 26 counties in the south of Ireland gain their independence. The new republic is populated by 3 million people, overwhelmingly Irish and Catholic. But the Irish Republicans' victory is far from complete. The 6 counties in the north of Ireland, the most industrial part of the island, is retained by the British. 500,000 Irish people, Catholics, dedicated to the reunification of their country, must now live in a statelet controlled by 1 million loyalists, ancestors of the Scottish colonialists who arrived in the 17th century. The Scots happen to be Protestants. In Northern Ireland, the Loyalists have everything: the police, the judicial system, public housing, and the major sources of employment. The Nationalists have systematic discrimination. This profound social division is the source of the violent troubles that the region has experienced for more than 80 years. At the end of the 1960s, Irish nationalists demonstrate non-violently for social equality. The civil rights movement, inspired by black Americans, demands simple, fundamental rights such as one man, one vote. The response by the police is systematic and brutal.
They got into the water and they came after us.
We tried
to go up the back field to get away from them. They surrounded us in the back field. We were stuck in the water. We waded in and out of the water for half a dozen times, up to our waists. And they all battered us. And they took the single, they took the fella singly and they battered him. And then they came for another fella and then they battered him.
Do you know who
they
were?
They did them all single. There's a fella lying down there and he's half dead.
The non-violent civil rights movement ironically provokes violent confrontations between the nationalists and the loyalists. John Hume, one of the most popular nationalist leaders, unlike the IRA, has always worked for a peaceful political solution to the conflict. He has been elected several times to the British and European parliaments and remains one of the principal protagonists of the Troubles.
Well, the city where we're standing and where I grew up was the worst example of injustice in the old Northern Ireland. The city of Derry here had a 70% Catholic population, 30% Protestant population. Catholics were broadly nationalist, Protestants were broadly unionist, yet the 30% unionists governed the city by a system of gerrymander. They controlled the housing, and therefore they divided the city into 3 voting districts. Behind me was the voting district, which was largely the Catholics, where 70% of the population lived. They elected 8 representatives. The other 2 districts elected 6 representatives each, even though they had only 15% of the population in each of them. So the 30% of the population governed the city. And in order to govern it, of course, we didn't have one person, one vote. Only ratepayers had a vote. And at the time when I was growing up, for example, the mayor of the city, because he owned 7 limited companies, had 6 votes for each company plus his own vote. He had 43 votes.
After an endless spiral of demonstrations and repression, the loyalist police and nationalist community enter into a virtual civil war. In August 1969, their attacks against nationalist districts in Belfast result in 6 deaths and hundreds of injured. More than 2,000 homes are burnt down. Rosaline and Martin Walsh lived at that time in West Belfast, the district to be hit the hardest. They still live there, in this nationalist enclave where Martin drives a taxi. Both are Republican activists, and between them they have served more than 10 years in prison.
There was no protection then for Catholics because the police let them do what they wanted. In fact, As far as I recall now, it was said by witnesses who were put out of their homes that police actually pointed out Catholic homes in Cooper Street. I think that's been well documented.
Well, what happened is they came down every other night and it was going on for a period of time. And as Rosine said, they came down, the police came with them, with the police specials. They did point out houses that worked at different things, but what actually happened when the whole thing went up in smoke is the loyalist crowd came in, the Catholics beat them back with sticks and stones. But when they come down in the armoured cars, you just firing, was the burning, big burning shells they were firing, taking lumps out of bricks and everything. They were firing just at anybody and everybody. Also, the loyalists had their own guns, they had their shotguns, they had their own licensed guns. They were firing them, when the Catholics had nothing whatsoever. Gerard McCauley, a wee lad from Cooper Street, around that way, he come from Clannard, he was shot dead. He's only a young lad.
He was helping people to evacuate.
Helping people. Even when they didn't even let the people get their stuff out of their houses.
The Nationalists are not the only victims of the violence of 1969. Protestants living in mixed districts must also abandon their homes. Raymond Laverty, Loyalist militant, works today with young people in both communities.
When I was growing up, till the age of 9, I lived in what would be termed as an interface area, which was quite close Protestant Catholic. I had quite a lot of Catholic friends at that early age. Come to 1970, my family moved out of that area because of the conflict, the nightly violence that was going on. They couldn't hack it anymore, so we moved further up the road. I don't think I was probably made aware at that stage that there was a, if you like, a difference between Protestant and Catholics. But before that, I would never have been aware. We were just all friends who played about, and no one asked, were you a Protestant or were you a Catholic at that early age? So I had the innocence of childhood there. But whenever 69 came and we've seen different incidents and things, then I start to realise there's something wrong here. This is not normal.
August 1969. The breakdown of the statelet and the Loyalist police force inspires London finally to intervene. The government sends promises of democratic reforms to the Nationalists, but at the same time 9,000 British soldiers are sent to Northern Ireland. Their official mission, establish peace between the two communities. But very quickly, in the eyes of the Nationalists, these troops become an occupying army.
And the British army stood there yesterday, and when the first house went up in smoke, we pleaded, we just stood down there and we cried for them to get something done about it. Do you know what they turned around and told us? It was their own homes that could do whatever they liked with them.
What were relations here like?
Our relations was very good with the Protestant people in this street.
Was there ever anybody burned out here from 1969?
Our relations. There's a man there, a Protestant man, and he's sitting, he's standing there crying his heart out, for he doesn't want to leave the street.
At the end of the 1960s, the IRA is divided, demoralised, and worst of all, lacks arms. The clandestine organisation is incapable of fulfilling one of its most fundamental roles, defending the Nationalist community. Through this crisis, a new generation of Republicans take charge. Their leader, Gerry Adams.
Well, I got involved in politics almost by accident, around 1964. When I was witness, when I was going to college, to an attack by the RUC upon a Sinn Féin election room in Divis Street in West Belfast. And they went in and seized the Irish National flag, which was being displayed in the window of the election office. And they did so under the Special Powers Act, which was a special piece of repressive legislation at that time. And that led to what was called the Divis Street Rats. But what it sweated in my consciousness was an appetite to find out how they could do this, why they would do it, what type of system there was here. And then I got increasingly involved in housing agitation in Sinn Féin, which was then a banned organization. And I was a founder member of the Civil Rights Association. And in the pogroms of 1969, I had dropped out of college and was working as a barman. And I left work, I left employment, and have been working more or less since then in full-time political activism.
This is the AR-15. The first thing you do when you take possession of any weapon, you check it for safe. If there's a magazine on it, you release it. You check the breech by touch and by sight, impossible. Check the safe. Put the weapon off cock.
At the beginning of 1970, thanks to support from the powerful Irish community in the United States, the IRA quickly becomes capable not only of defending the nationalist community, but also of making attacks on the British forces and economic targets. Northern Ireland is in a state of war and with a vengeance. Every single day, the IRA carries out attacks. In 2 years, more than 200 British soldiers and policemen are killed. At the same time, bomb attacks, despite prior warnings, kill many innocent civilians. The British attempt to crush the clandestine army. Gerry Adams is identified as the head of the IRA in Belfast and becomes the most wanted man in the United Kingdom.
I was first arrested in March 1972, which was some months after internment had been introduced on August the 9th, 1971. And the British had always retained, and retain yet, the capacity to arrest and to imprison without trial people for indefinite periods. And internment has been used in the 20s, in the 30s, in the 40s and 50s, in 1969. And the people who were arrested in 1971 were very badly beaten, and their cases were taken to European Court of Human Rights, and the British government was indicted for inhuman and degrading treatment of prisoners. I also was brutalized. And the brutality consisted just of systematic torture in the form of being denied sleep, being made to stand in a search position, feet apart, fingers to the wall, being beaten around the groin, the kidneys, the back, on an ongoing basis by different teams of and interrogators. So it wasn't a matter of a particularly brutal IUC man or British soldier, it was a matter of a systematic modality and methodology of interrogation which the British had perfected.
1971. British repression is facilitated by the Special Powers Act. More than 1,100 people, all nationalists, are arrested and imprisoned indefinitely. No charges, no trial.
When I was in Armagh prison, I had political status. My crime was my opposition to the British presence in the six counties of our country. When I was released from Armagh,
it was about 6 months later, we met in a friend's flat. I knew Martin, I think it was 12 weeks when we got married, and we were married 8 weeks when he was arrested and sentenced to 12 years. So really, we didn't know one another. The night before he was arrested, I had it confirmed that I was pregnant. So there was I, jobless, pregnant, and my husband in prison with little prospects of getting out. When our daughter was born, our visits were out of a year, 6 hours a year. That was 1.5 hour each month. And I remember when he was in about 3 years, receiving a letter. In the letter, he said, what school did you go to? What type of music do you like? Who's your favorite film star? We just didn't know each other. We knew each other, I suppose, well enough to know that maybe we could spend the rest of our lives together, but we really didn't know a lot about each other.
As I moved through my life, as a 17-year-old, I was shot by the IRA. I was coming home from a disco in the centre of the town, and a gunman opened up from a Catholic enclave in the Short Strand. And,
okay,
you know, I was unfortunately the one who got hit. I was paralysed, I was hit in the shoulder and spent a bit of time in hospital. That, I have to say, among other things at that time, influenced some of my decisions.
Tell you what it is. We're from a progressive unionist party in the area, Big Davy Irvine. What we're doing is we're just asking three basic questions. We see this, the area is getting run down and stuff.
I then felt very angry. I became very close to the thinking of loyalist paramilitaries in my own area. I seen a number of my friends killed. I socialised in the circle of paramilitaryism. I went to prison in 1983 for on the word of a loyalist supergrass who alleged that I carried out acts of violence against the Republican movement, which I denied.
Despite the war and the repression, the non-violent movement for civil rights remains active. Sunday, January 31st, 1972, a large demonstration is organised in Derry. More than 20,000 people are present, a day that will forever remain in the memory of the Irish nationalists. Bloody Sunday.
To be dead. There are the three in that Saracen car. There are two men lying at the end of this block of flats. There's another man at least very close to being dead. There's one, there are two others up there. I'm told that there are some more in these flats here that I haven't seen yet. I would say there are probably about four dead at this moment. I don't know what those are doing, whether they're alive or dead, but they seem to be very dead, and they're thrown in as if they were dead meat.
How long must we sing this song? How long must we sing this song? How long must we sing this song? mix that they were on. Finally show some decency. Reparation to each family. Treat our people with some dignity. Man, you know this shit really gets to me. The way they try to deny my history. 25 years on, our people getting strong. Thought they hit the bricks that it's time to move on. Order to border to be cast out.
Bloody Sunday strengthens the position of the IRA and weakens that of the British. Under considerable pressure, London grants political status to prisoners and releases Gerry Adams from Longkesh prison to negotiate.
Well, I was taken from internment in June 1972, and myself and a man called Dahi O'Connell actually negotiated out with British officials, whose names escape me at this time. The conditions which then led to a bilateral truce between the IRA and the British. And in the gap created by that truce, there were talks between a Republican delegation and the British minister who was in charge at that time, a man called Whitelaw. I travelled to London in, I think, June of 72. We were actually flown to London by the British. And we did a meeting which explored the possibilities of peace. And remember that we're now back to that 23, 24 years later. And all the people who have died in between times and all the grieving that has occurred in between times, I think you get some sense of the just the obscenity of British policy towards Ireland. That British politicians have always preferred the security option. Treat this like a security problem. This is a problem of terrorism or of gangsterism, of tribal differences. When in fact the British government fails all the time to face up to its responsibilities. And any documentary which looks at this, which doesn't have the British government in here as a player, not as a referee, not as a facilitator, but as a main player. This isn't loyalist and unionist and Republicans and nationalists. This is Ireland, in which there are differences of political allegiance, surely, and there are deep divisions. But the cause of all of this, the source of all of this, rests with the British involvement in our affairs.
After only a two-week truce, the negotiations collapse. Gerry Adams returns to Ireland and clandestinity. What follows is a very long war. In 1978, a secret report written by the British General Glover states that a military solution to the conflict is impossible. The IRA, given their manpower, experience, financial and armed resources, is capable of continuing the war as long as the British remain. Events soon proved General Glover to be right. On August 27, 1979, the IRA blows up the yacht on which Lord Mountbatten, the Queen's uncle, the last Viceroy of India, and symbol of the colonial British Empire, is holidaying off the coast of Ireland. Britain is in shock. The deaths of 18 British soldiers caught in an IRA ambush on the same day goes almost unnoticed. Incapable of breaking the Irish Republican movement in the street, London attempts to do so in the prisons. The The British decide to abolish political prisoner status, which means, amongst other things, that Republican prisoners must wear a prison uniform. They refuse. Naked, with only blankets for clothing, they are denied the right to leave their cells, not even to go to the toilets. They have no choice but to smear their excrement on the walls. This situation lasts for over 4 years.
We're political prisoners! We want political status! We're political prisoners! Up the road!
Only later I realized the smell was a smell like death. That's the only way I can describe it. The visits each month you went up, you didn't think it could get worse or they could look any worse, but each month you went up, it was worse. So each visit was actually a dread. And of course, during the hunger strike, it was just like being in a different world. It's words can't adequately describe what that was like. And I had no one on hunger strike, no one belonged to me was on it, but yet these men, it had the same effect. It could have been my father, my sister, my brother. We all felt as one.
October 17, 1980. In the Longkesh prison, in order to regain political prisoner status, 7 Republican prisoners start a hunger strike.
The whole system in Northern Ireland, both special arrest, special court system without jury, has proved to us beyond all doubt that these courts are set up to convict men, just to convince people that we are criminals, which we are not. We are a product of the political troubles in Northern Ireland at this moment. And the reason why we went on hunger strike is because after 4 years of long protesting, in which we embarked on the dirty protest, after long talks, we felt that our position had to be highlighted, and the only way left us was by hunger strike.
Well, like, I must abide by my son's wishes, and if he thinks he can do good for the rest of the boys sitting on the protest, well, then I must accept it.
If he dies, do you really think they will achieve anything?
Well, that remains to be seen.
Ray McCartney and his comrades do not die. After 53 days of hunger strike, an agreement between the prisoners and the British government seems to have been reached. But the agreement collapses. On March 1, 1981, Bobby Sands, the leader of the IRA at Longkesh, starts a second hunger strike. Every 2 weeks, a prisoner joins the movement. The popular mobilisation in favour of the hunger strikes is enormous, and so is the repression. The hunger strikers face certain death. In order to save them, Sinn Féin, the political wing of the IRA, decides to break a long-held taboo and participate in British elections. At that time, no law prevented an inmate from standing in elections. The Republican movement enters Bobby Sands as a candidate in a by-election to the British Parliament. On April 9, 1981, the election results are announced.
For each candidate at the election was as follows.
Sands, Bobby, anti-H bloc,
Parmar, political prisoner, 30,000.
Yeah!
And I declare that Bobby Sands has been duly elected.
After Bobby Sands, two other hunger strikers, Kieran Doherty and Paddy Agnew, are also elected, this time to the Parliament in the Irish Republic. At that moment, many thought that the political credibility of the Republican movement would be sufficient to save the hunger strikers. Margaret Thatcher was the British Prime Minister.
There can be no question of political status for someone who is serving a sentence for crime. Crime is crime is crime. It is not political, it is crime.
May 5th, 1981. Bobby Sands dies. In Belfast, more than 100,000 people attend his funeral. Despite this expression of popular feeling, 9 other hunger strikers will follow him. Ten men dead. Republican prisoners, demoralized, abandon the hunger strike. Shortly afterwards, James Pryor becomes the new minister for Northern Ireland. Without uttering the words political status, he simply and quietly restores it. The conflict enters a new phase. Sinn Féin commits itself to the political path opened by the election of Bobby Sands.
Well, it's out of our comprehension. We can't really understand how it really felt for families wanting their sons to live, but having to abide by what the sons wanted. It was just sometime after the hunger strike, I think, hope was born. Sinn Féin decided the time was right to stand for election, to give us one voice, an overall voice. And thankfully, Gerry Adams was elected MP for Westminster in 1983. And that was the birth of hope.
The difference between that period and now, not least given the number of people who have died in between times, is that when the struggle stopped, even for the short time that it stopped in 72, and later in 74, when Republicans also talked to the British, the struggle was more or less limited to a military struggle, more or less. There was obviously a very popular dimension to it, but it was more or less manifested itself in military resistance by the IRA. Now, when armed struggle stops, the struggle doesn't stop, because the struggle has been broadened, it is popularly based, it is structural. Sinn Féin, for example, is now the third largest party in the North.
Escape from any prison in any country in any struggle.
especially in my own area. I've thought of so many people out there that I know, so many people that have supported me and supported the prisoners over the years. Ours is a wee standing up there, down here, right on our line. People that looked after us, fed us, clothed us. A big round of applause for the people that supported O'Neill Ireland.
June 1983. Gerry Adams is elected to the British Parliament. 3 months later, Bick McFarlane and 37 other Republican prisoners escape from Longkesh prison. Henceforth, the conflict will have two fronts, political and military. October 13, 1984, Brighton, England. The IRA blows up the hotel lodging the entire British government on the occasion of the annual convention of the Conservative Party. Margaret Thatcher and her ministers come very close to death. This time there was no warning.
I just turned to do one final paper and then it went off. My husband was in bed and all the windows went. Yeah. And the bathroom was extremely badly damaged.
In your own room?
Yes.
In your room?
Yes.
I think that's enough for
us. We were very lucky.
I am a representative of the General Headquarters staff of Aughlin Aheron, the IRA. I don't see any merit in discussing individuals as targets. Suffice it to say that the people who legislate for the terror in Ireland know well that they all remain targets. And I'm sure that Mrs. Thatcher, when she goes down upon her knees with a mirror checking underneath her car every morning, remembers the terror she inflicted on Ireland.
We're not gonna be firing yet for a wee while. Right.
How do you acquire your arms?
With extreme ingenuity, and there's no way that any representative of a guerrilla organization is going to enter into a discussion of how we've been continually supplied.
February 18th, 1991, 8 a.m. A bomb explodes at Victoria Station, one of London's largest train stations. One person is killed and several are injured.
There were warnings by telephone, specific warnings naming 9 railroad stations in London and saying that incendiary devices would explode within 50 minutes. The operation was not aimed at killing anyone. The operation was aimed at paralysing London and bringing home to the British people the reality of the disruption which their military presence inflicts on the people of Ireland.
February 1991. John Major, the successor of Margaret Thatcher as Prime Minister, also becomes a target of the IRA. 3 mortar bombs just missed 10 Downing Street, where Major and his ministers discuss another war, that of the Gulf.
I'm grateful, firstly, that no one has been injured, but I think the terrorists really should have learned now that neither in Belfast, nor in London, nor in anywhere else in the United Kingdom will they be able to bomb people out of their normal activities, their homes, their schools, or anything else. If they want to reinforce our determination to make sure we defeat them, this is the way to do it.
Are they the same type of devices that was fired at Downing Street?
The exact same device. And the ones that were fired in Downing Street had Semtex high explosives in them. 45 pound of Semtex.
Our strategy is that through the effective use of guerrilla warfare and through continually maintaining an effective fighting force, we will eventually sap the political will of the British government to remain in Ireland. If the British government were prepared to show even one iota of leadership and were to begin moves to disengage from this country, then the conflict would cease.
With no sign from London, the IRA's actions in England continue. In 1992 and 93, the Republicans hit where it hurts the most. Enormous bombs explode in the city of London, Europe's most important financial centre. The economic costs of these two actions are more than £2 billion, more costly than all the bombs that had exploded in Northern Ireland since the beginning of the war. The British repression keeps pace. During the 1980s, more than 40 alleged members of the IRA are not arrested, but summarily executed. On March 6, 1988, in Gibraltar, three unarmed Irish militants are simply shot dead by the British Secret Service. Ten days later, their funeral in Belfast is attended by an enormous crowd.
At the time, I didn't know what was happening. I just heard the explosion. There was panic. At the same time, the large group of young people continually chased the man. The man was throwing bombs, and as the bomb came towards the crowd ducked. I jumped over that railing and ran towards the place where the bombs were coming from. I couldn't believe it when I seen so many people running towards a man firing a gun and throwing bombs at them. They continually chased him until they eventually caught him at the very bottom down there.
Three people are killed, many others injured. The author of the attack, Michael Stone, is a member of a loyalist paramilitary group.
It's a symptom of British rule in Ireland. The guy was throwing bombs at us, shooting at us, and he didn't know why. Either through bigotry or hatred of some sort. I think he's a victim. He's as much a victim as the three people he killed that day.
Throughout the 25 years, we opposed that violence. And it got to the stage where I thought, when 20,000 British soldiers couldn't stop the killings on my streets, and 12,000 armed policemen couldn't stop the killings, I felt that if I could save a single human life by talking directly to people, it was my duty to do so. So the dialogue opened between my party, SDLP and Sinn Féin, the political arm of the IRA, and it ended up with private dialogue between myself and Gerry Adams. And the basis of that dialogue throughout was to achieve a total end to violence, followed by all party talks with both governments, whose objective would be agreement among our divided people, and that agreement would have to have the allegiance of both sections of our people. In other words, a process that threatened no section of our people.
It was first in 1988 that John Hume and Gerry Adams met to discuss a peaceful political solution to the conflict. Henceforth, Adams is recognised as a key man, the person that can convince the IRA to engage in a ceasefire. Nonetheless, in the United Kingdom and in the Irish Republic, he remains the object of a strange form of censorship.
For an IRA ceasefire, if the government agree with the Hume Adams proposal, under the government ban, we can't broadcast.
Well, I don't know the mechanics of what happened yesterday, but you cannot justify made a mess of it. Well, I don't know the mechanics of what happened yesterday, but you cannot divorce, and this is not a justification for what happened, because I don't believe what happened is justifiable. Whatever the intention was, the end result was disastrous. That's it. It wasn't bad.
There was a rather ingenious device developed where the letter of the law said that the voices of Sinn Féin spokesperson couldn't be broadcast. So the journalists then, some of them tried to get around that by using actors' voices, which was initially, I suppose, to show the absurdity of the law. But because people forget about that, it became rather silly from our point of view, because your voice was stolen. Rightly or wrongly, the nuances, the character, the complexities, the gestures were all removed. So that one had me or people like me speaking with Scottish accents, Welsh accents, English accents, maybe French accents. And depending on how committed the actor was, it was either a good job or it was synchronized and so on, or it was just a complete farce.
We have waited for too long for our freedom. We are demanding of Mr. Major's government that he takes decisive steps now to move the situation forward in a fundamental way.
Oh, I think obviously that all of us have to persuade each other about the type of New Ireland we shape out. But I mean, the British government is saying now, by its predetermined policy, that nationalists have to remain in a partitioned island.
Well, the main reason for painting murals is to express what this community feels. This community has suffered a lot in the past 27 years and have been isolated and demonized by the British government. And also we have to deal with censorship, and the truth is never really told by the local media especially, which is directed by the British government and British intelligence. So we feel, in order to get our message across, is the best way we find is to actually paint murals, to come out and to involve the community, to involve children in expressing exactly how we feel about the situation that we live in.
Though the Constitution of the Irish Republic lays claim to sovereignty of the whole island, Dublin has always preferred to ignore the Troubles and chosen to give a free hand to the British authorities. In 1992, the election of Albert Reynolds as Prime Minister of the Republic of Ireland brings radical change to the political situation.
My role in the peace process started on the day that I was elected Taoiseach or Prime Minister of Ireland. So, on the day after I took office, I was briefed by my advisors on the progress that John Hume had made with Gerry Adams in conversations over a long period. And having spoken to John Hume and invited him to a meeting, he briefed me and brought me up to date with as far as their conversations had gone. In other words, he believed that there was a definite window of opportunity for peace, but that he and Gerry Adams talking couldn't advance it any further, and consequently it needed the involvement at that point of the two governments, the British government and the Irish government. So I decided to take the particular risks for peace in making a decision that I was going to do everything I could to advance the peace process. And so I opened negotiations with John Major on a confidential basis, behind the scenes. And I established a number of links of communication to Sinn Féin on the one hand, to loyalist paramilitary spokesmen on the other, and over a period, taking the position where John Hume and Gerry Adams had reached, taking that and inputting that into what eventually became the Downing Street Declaration, produced on December the 15th, 1993.
The Taoiseach and I have now agreed on a joint declaration on Northern Ireland. It is a declaration for democracy and dialogue, and it is based on consent. It makes no compromise on strongly held principles, but it does embody our common view that there is an opportunity to end violence for good in Northern Ireland.
For the first time since 1972, the British government announces that it is ready to negotiate officially with the Irish Republicans and that everything will be on the table, including the reunification of Ireland. The Downing Street Declaration states that all the parties of the conflict shall be invited to negotiations, including Sinn Féin. The only precondition, the IRA must observe a durable ceasefire.
This is a historic opportunity for peace. We hope that everybody will grasp it.
Reynolds, an astute politician, is able to create a new dynamic peace process associating both Sinn Féin and the London government.
Is that both communities can fulfill
after 25 years of war that has cost more than 3,000 deaths and 40,000 injured, that is no mean task. The next important step is for Sinn Féin to convince the IRA to risk a ceasefire.
My government took decisions to lift the ban on interviews on the national airwaves for Sinn Féin spokespersons, to give a commitment to review the political prisoner situation on Irish soil, and to advocate that the British do likewise, and that I would bring the Sinn Féin into the political process a week after we had a ceasefire, and of course to support the application of Gerry Adams for a visa to enter the United States, where he had been banned for 20 years or more.
February 1994. Thanks to the personal intervention of President Clinton, Gerry Adams obtains his visa for the United States. In a country with more than 40 million citizens of Irish origin, Adams' visit is a historical event.
Peace has to be built on equal rights, it has to be built on an end to discrimination, and it has to be built on a democracy in which it's the people of Northern Ireland that guide and determine their future, not an outside occupying force. But the
Bill Clinton pursues a different and opposing policy to his predecessors, Bush and Reagan. By opening the doors of America and the White House to Gerry Adams, he offers him a powerful argument to convince the IRA to call a ceasefire.
I persisted because I believe it could be done, and I believe that the greatest challenge to a political leader was indeed in the area of saving human life. That would be the greatest personal satisfaction for me if I could say that I contributed to the saving of human life. Eventually, we got a ceasefire on the 31st of August, 1994, by the IRA. It was a ceasefire, in my view, that was intended to be for good and to leave all violence behind. President Clinton was the very first on the phone to say, well done, congratulations. I'm glad that I had belief in what you were saying. And John Major was through within 10 minutes later to say, you were right and I was wrong. So we're finally over the hurdle. We're into a whole peace environment, which all of us indeed wanted.
But we are going to have our freedom, and that freedom is going to embrace Unionists and Nationalists, Catholics and Protestants and dissenters, and a free and united Irish Republic.
Hello, Minister, you're talking about peace. Can I say something? Peace is brilliant here in Ireland.
The major loyalist parties are reluctant to enter a peace process they do not control. Only the Progressive Unionist Party, stemming from one of the most violent loyalist movements, seems ready to play for peace. David Irvine is their leader.
It's good news that there are people in the nationalist community who are saying, yes, I like what they're saying, that's interesting. I think that that lends itself, I hope, to an opportunity in the future. But our biggest issues at this moment in time are probably the difficulties within the unionist community and the sense of fear and foreboding. As we move towards that relentless march for change, which will culminate, I hope, in agreement, but not before, of course, those who have killed each other sit down and face each other across the negotiating table. That will be difficult. It will be extremely emotional. But if I had one word to describe Northern Ireland today and yesterday and in the past, it would be emotional.
Despite the IRA ceasefire, the realisation of immediate negotiations simply does not happen. Instead, John Major's government introduces a new precondition. The IRA must give up their arms before Sinn Féin will be allowed into negotiations. The peace process may be real, but it is evidently very fragile.
Within the British establishment or within unionism that the IRA would disarm. Who do they think they were kidding? They know that you people here are unbeatable. They know it throughout the world. The struggle for Irish freedom has found an echo everywhere.
The refusal of the IRA to surrender weapons is the perfect and expected pretext for the main Unionist Party to refuse all form of negotiations with Sinn Féin. John Taylor is a leader of the Ulster Unionist Party.
Gerry Adams, I have never met, of course. He's a former IRA man, commander, I think former. He may be still in IRA for all I know, but he certainly was at one time commander of the IRA in Belfast. He's a terrorist. He's now giving the impression that he's restricting his life to political activity. Not only have I not met him, I would not be prepared to meet him until I know that his movement, the Republican movement, has rejected violence. And that's in his grasp, if he agrees to the principle of decommissioning. Why do people who want to become politicians and reject violence want to keep Semtex for bombs, do you see? That's what we say to ourselves. So as a gesture, let them give in some Semtex, and that will show that they really want to come into the political process.
This was not part of the Downing Street Declaration negotiations. It was not part of the framework document. It was never agreed that there would be a precondition for handing over arms. And I said on a number of occasions that it wouldn't work, that it wasn't a runner, and neither it was a runner. So the British government put in this new precondition for to hand over arms before they got into talk. Republican leadership couldn't and wouldn't accept that for many reasons, for historical reasons, that it was the only place in the world in conflict resolution where arms were asked to be handed over in advance. Didn't happen in Bosnia, didn't happen in the Middle East, didn't happen in South Africa.
In November 1995, for the first time in history, a US president makes an official visit to Northern Ireland. Bill Clinton, aware of the dead end that the peace process is in, proposes a simple solution. Begin talks as soon as possible, including Sinn Féin, and at the same time set up a parallel commission to discuss decommissioning of the IRA.
Decommissioning of arms is perfectly clear. If people are prepared to enter into the democratic process, then they don't need arms. If they need arms, then there must be a question about how serious they are about entering into the democratic process. Now, we need to examine this matter. It isn't a matter of semantics. It isn't a matter of detail. It is a matter of principle, and it is a matter of practice. Thank you very much.
Despite pressure from the Americans, John Major maintains his precondition for IRA disarmament. With virtually no majority in Parliament, the Conservative government can stay in power only with the support of the 9 Unionist deputies who wish to see the IRA give up their arms. For 17 months, London lives under the illusion that an undefeated army would surrender. February 9th, 1996. A two-ton bomb devastates Canary Wharf, the new business district of London. Two civilians are killed. The material damage is estimated at several hundred million pounds. Irish Republicans and the British are once again at war.
I'll never forget the night the ceasefire broke. I was on my way to the shops. Everyone was the usual jovial mood. And on the way back, my sister ran out of the house shouting, "The ceasefire's broke. There's a bomb in England." And I was devastated. Everyone was devastated. Though in saying that, not surprised. People who wouldn't have voted Sinn Féin express views for months about John Major's intransigence on the peace process. We didn't seem to be getting anywhere, and he seemed really just to be using us as a stalling ploy to keep his own power.
Well, Madam Speaker, if I understand rightly, the events...
May 1st, 1997. The Labour Party, led by Tony Blair, wins the general elections in a massive landslide. One of his electoral promises was to re-establish the peace process. To this end, he names Mo Molan as Secretary of State for Northern Ireland. The political landscape of Northern Ireland is overturned by the elections. The SDLP, John Hume's moderate nationalist party, together with the Republicans of Sinn Féin, obtained their best election result ever, with 43% of the vote. Gerry Adams and Martin McInnes, two of the historical leaders of the Republican movement, are elected to the British Parliament. For a long time thought to be the true leaders of the IRA, they are seen by the nationalist electorate as the guarantors of the peace process.
Just one short sentence. I've been asked by a number of journalists whether or not Sinn Féin enjoyed the support of the Republican people. You have given them their answer today.
Despite the hope brought by the elections, the revival of the peace process is slow to show itself. On the 16th of June in Lurgan, an IRA unit shoots two policemen dead.
And their tears were running down my face this morning, and I seen them lying on the footpath. Why did they do this? Why?
And indeed, throughout this land, we're not...
In Northern Ireland, it is often guns that ask the hardest questions.
Have no hope.
Tony Blair's reply was to come quickly. 10 days later, he announced that, in the event of a new IRA ceasefire, Sinn Féin would be admitted to the talks within 6 weeks. The British no longer required IRA decommissioning. But an important hurdle remained to be crossed. The Loyalist marches, which each year celebrate the conquest of Ireland in the 17th century. The Republicans addressed the new Labour government. Will it authorise Portadown Loyalists to march through the small nationalist enclave on the Gavarkie Road?
It's a small nicest community which is surrounded by a loyalist area, and basically the community stays within its own community, because if they come out and go into the centre of Portadown, they can't be kicked to death, which has happened. So four artists, we decided that we would go down and paint one mural, something about rerouting the parade. So we painted three murals in 3 days. And while we were painting the mural, we finished it just before the parades were to enter into the Gavarkie Road. And at about 2 o'clock in the morning, the siren went off in the area, the local warning. So we decided to go down and see what was happening.
July 7th, 1997. In the middle of the night, the 8,000 residents of the Gavarkie Road attempt to oppose the deployment of 5,000 police officers and British soldiers who occupy the locality to accommodate the march. Hours later, thanks to the massive presence of the security forces, the loyalists marched through the nationalist ghetto.
I try to think what it must have been like 400 years ago when the British came in and pushed the Catholics off their land and pushed them back into Connacht, to the bad land of Ireland. And their houses were taken over, their land was taken over, and the Loyalists and the Protestant settlers were given their land. And it just seemed so
similar, that nothing had changed in 400 years, that they were marched through our land 400 years ago, and in 1987 they were still marched through us. They needed the British Army and the RUC. They needed a military invasion to push and march loyalists down through a Catholic area to stamp their authority on us.
Yes, black fuck pots! LVF punch, masks! Get the fuck! Nazis! They're not even fucking Nazis, they're UVF men!
Jesus Christ, who loves all, who draws all towards God the Father. He loves you and he loves me, and he also loves these soldiers here and those RUC men. They're all God's people, they're all God's children. And Jesus is the way to the Father.
I will come back with a nice feature using sound from this open air mass. Because the irony of this is that the Protestants argued that they needed their march as part of their freedom to worship, and now the Catholics in this area, penned in by the troops who are preventing them from interfering with the march, are unable to get the mass themselves and are holding an open-air mass instead. Adam Rayfield, CBS News, Portadown, Northern Ireland.
Richard Priest,
a good name for a priest.
It runs in the family.
Father Larkin, Father Sean.
Welcome.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
So
oh dear.
You realise why we had the mass here, don't you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Makes life a lot easier all round.
Well, they weren't able to get to their normal place of worship.
Yes, a source of sadness.
Couldn't get up the road to
yes.
Parish Church up on the Gavahi mm-hmm. Road.
Yes. And sometimes I have to bring the sacrament to the people as well.
Yes, yes.
There's a bit of a difference.
Okay, so thank you for going down.
Okay, yes,
thank you
very much.
Do come over if you've got a chance.
Okay. Why could we not go to our mass?
Thank you very much.
Why could we not go to our mass? Why could we not go to our mass?
The events of Gavaki Road are followed by rioting throughout Northern Ireland. Once again, the peace process seems to be at a dead end. The hopes for peace will be played out in a tiny nationalist neighbourhood of Belfast, the Ormo Road. There, as every summer, the Loyalists plan to march.
Everybody around the world knows what happened on Gavaki Road and the Ormo Road over this last number of years is wrong. They've seen it on their television sets. We are saying today, it is over. It is finished. Your state is stinking. 3 years in a row, this community has been brutalized by the RUC. It has been intimidated and humiliated by the Orange Order. Mo would say that both sides are evil. But who was beating anybody on the Armour Road last year? Who was curfewing people in their homes? Who beat the people off Gavaki Road? Who threatened to murder the people of Gavaki Road? There's only one evil side in this Mo, and it's your state.
Faced with a chaotic situation, at the last minute, the British government succeeds in convincing the Loyalists to reroute their march. And a few days later, on the 20th of July 1997, the IRA responds with a new ceasefire.
You do believe that in September you'll be sitting down around the table with all the other parties?
Well, we will certainly be sitting down at the table, and I want to see all of the other parties represented there as well.
How will they do that? I mean, some of the Unionist Party is saying that how can they believe you again?
Well, they don't need to believe me. They need to believe themselves. They need to have confidence in themselves. They need to have the courage of their convictions. They need to move forward. They need to call ceasefires in their heads. They need to decommission mindsets which prevent dialogue. And, you know, I want to listen, and they want, I hope, eventually, to listen. But I want to also say that in their minds, unionist leaders know they'll talk to Sinn Féin. They know they'll be part of a democratic peace resolution. Why not do it in September? Why put it off again?
All right. Tony Blair sticks to his promise. Only 2 weeks after the ceasefire, instead of 6 weeks as planned, a Sinn Féin delegation led by Gerry Adams is invited to meet the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, Mo Mullum. Real negotiations can now start.
Hiya, thanks very much.
For an Irish Republican Party, we want to see an end to British rule on this island. We want to see the people of this island living together in unity and in peace, and we'd certainly be arguing for a strategy which the British government should join with the Irish government and the rest of us to bring that about.
Gerry Adams' appearance, along with Sinn Féin at Stormont in discussion with the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, is significant. I think it's a landmark. It's an indicator, one hopes, of things to come, of a democratic path perhaps being followed by violent nationalism, where once before only violence seemed to be the suggestion of removing the British from the island of Ireland. However, I'm a unionist, I'm British, and only between the British populace in this community and the Irish populace in this community can there be agreement. And I think rather Gerry Adams, whilst indicating a movement towards democracy, is wasting his time if he thinks he can achieve agreement within Northern Ireland directly through a British government.
I feel that when David Irvine, people like that, came on the scene, it was like a breath of fresh air. Hearing them speak about their community, it was just unbelievable. It showed, I think, loyalists as well as Republicans that we have more in common than differences. I think they have shown that together we can be a strong and united people, but apart we just can't survive. I think we will all find that we can share in the equality. We will help to build our new society.
I have more in common with Catholic working class people than I have against them. You know, I suffer the same problems of where's the next loaf of bread coming from, housing problems, as the people in the Short Strand, the Catholic area in the Short Strand do. But I know that I don't suffer the same problems as unionists, middle class unionists who live up in the leafy suburbs, and the only people that are talking sense are ex-prisoners, people who were in prison for what they believed in, whether they be loyalist or Republican, but they're the only people that are talking about moving the process forward. Psychologically, it's going to take more than 50 years to break down the barriers, but I think what I seen in 17 months was that people were getting ready to take down the physical barriers which divide this city and divide this country, but it'll take a lot longer for the mentality of people.
On December 19, 1997, Gerry Adams and a Sinn Féin delegation meet with Tony Blair. It is the first time since 1921 that an Irish Republican leader is invited to 10 Downing Street, the official residence of the Prime Minister. The same residence that was attacked by IRA mortars 7 years earlier.
We had a good meeting because I think we engaged. I think we faced up to the difficulties. In many ways, the engagement could be described as a moment in history. And we certainly had the opportunity to put our view that all of the hurt and grief and division which has come from British involvement in our affairs has to end. That will obviously mean facing up to the future with some resilience and with a determination to make a new history.
Since the partition of the country in 1921, Ireland has limped through its history. This double division, firstly of the nation and then of the two communities in the north, is a source of perpetual violence which convulses the island. Only the reunification of Ireland can bring an end to the conflict. How many more deaths are necessary before what is obvious is finally accepted? Between war and peace, the IRA and the British Army remain face to face.
I don't feel threatened by the soldiers at all. I'd be afraid of them rather than anything else.
Excuse me, can we word with you, please? Off camera.
I hate the way they have to kill. Like, what the IRA have killed and the Brits have killed. They should stop the killing altogether. Like, talks is the only way to sort it all out. I don't believe it's right at all to separate Ireland, that we would like to be called the whole United Ireland and have the same people as we are treated as Differners, Northerners and Southerners, and we're all the same.
We had a big family here and we lost one of them to the British Army, nearly lost the second. And we have went through a lot. My grandson in Cross Madeleine never knew his father. My daughter-in-law was only 20 years of age when she was made a widow. My son was also 20 when he was killed. So, those things make us all very sad. There's peace on at the moment. There's an IRA ceasefire. But the police were there, each of them with two guns, and harassed our young fellas about where they were going to and where they were coming from. Just yesterday evening at 3 o'clock. And if that's the peace we're going to get, I don't want a bloody bit of it. That's to be honest about it. That's not the sort of peace I want. I want peace when we can go our own roads with a police force. You need a police force of some sort, but a police force who are impartial, who are not bigots, and who will uphold the law, the law of Ireland. I don't want a British law. I want my own law in my own country.
Harassment from the British Army and the REC. They have no need to be in this area. There is a ceasefire on and they know. They are just provocating the children. As you can see, they are very small children. I suppose these children are the next generation of IRA volunteers. And unless this problem is sorted out, these young children here will be in the IRA. And what future have they got if there's no peace? I mean, I was 13 when the war started. These children have known nothing but the war. And it's about time for the Brits. It's just time for the go. Just go and leave us alone on our island in peace. That's all we ask. And while the Brits are here, these children's lives are in danger. Shall I?
Okay, y'all. Cool.
Yeah.
Sir Shah, Sir Shah, Sir Shah.